Welcome to the 1871 podcast. And on this episode, we are counting down our top five influential people in Reading's history. And this episode completes our Reading FC Top 100 series. So far, Johnny and I have chosen our 25 favourite Reading players each, our top 10 games, our top five seasons, and our top five managers. So if my maths is correct, that adds up to 45 each. And our five choices each for most influential people in Reading's history completes our Reading FC Top 100. So it's 50 each, albeit some of them were the same. So we chose the same top manager, etc. But we've had, this will mean we've had 50 each, which adds up to 100. My maths is good enough to know that, at least. So before we start, just another heads up about the guests coming up this week. So tomorrow we've got former Reading defender Andy Bernal as our guest. Thursday we've got Reading women's defender Liddy Woodham as our guest. And on Friday evening, our guest is another former Reading defender, Linvoy Primus. And all of those episodes are available anytime after 6 o'clock. And going back to our Reading FC Top 100 series, all of those episodes and all of the Series 2 episodes are still available to watch on YouTube or to listen to wherever you get your podcasts. So if you want to have a look back at our Steve Coppell episode, Marcus Hanneman, etc., you can do that. So those are the guests coming up. Johnny, just want to ask you a couple of things, a couple of developments this week. Yesterday, the season ticket price rise was announced. Mixed reaction. Some people saying, well, you know, it's less than inflation. Some people saying it's outrageous. What are your thoughts?
Bit of both, really. I think timing is never good, is it? I think when there's been, a tough end to a season and not much said afterwards, and I get that people want something from the owners. The owners don't speak because that's their choice. And then, you know, as I said before, you know, certain players, a few players have come out and said anything, but the captain hasn't. Little things like that mean a lot to fans. You know, it's communications are important in life, full stop. But in this kind of tough times, and then bang, you get the email about the season ticket prices and trying to make it all look good about, you know, I don't know, with the video of coming against penalty and us missing the penalty at the playoff final. I don't know how that sells season tickets, but hey-ho. It is what it is. To be fair to Reading over the years, they have kept season ticket prices the same or low. I think this is the first increase I think they've had for a while. It's. I think somebody pointed out that over a season, it's a small amount, but when people are on budgets for themselves, every penny hurts, you know, and that's where people feel like it's just another kick for being a Reading fan, you know.
It's the price of food is going up, the cost of living is going up. We all know some of the reasons why, the war in Ukraine, all that sort of thing. But Reading had that choice to make. That's what they've decided to do. And I've just had an announcement that my rent's gone up this week.
There you
go.
It is. Everything's going up, and it is. Yeah. You know, and people are, you know, maybe people's wages aren't going up, or if you know you're on a limited budget, it's tough. It's another thing for people to worry about. And
Johnny, you said everything's going up. Let's hope so.
Well, that's it. That's hopefully. I think you know, it's football is an outlet for a lot of people, me included. Yeah. I'm sure yourself, you know. That escapism or just, you know, catch up with people is huge. And if you now got to factor in extra costs for that, and then, you know, on top of that, it's also as well with all the travel, isn't it? You know, people, you know, get trains and petrol, and, you know, it's not an easy time for people, but, you know, that's the hard part of it. But it is what it is, and we'll see how that pans out over the next few months.
And another thing, I don't know if you know, Johnny, but people will want to get the new shirt with, if there's new players coming in, get the name on the back, that sort of thing. So that's always a cost. I don't really know the answer to this question. Maybe you can help. Do the cost of the shirts and that sort of thing, do they normally go up every year? I don't really know, to be honest.
It has been. I think it's been going up gradually. I think I remember the old days, you know, we used to have a shirt change maybe every two seasons, and it's about 40 quid. Now I think it's about 60. But, you know, people, young families, you times that cost by four, you know, for they want the shirts. But I know we're not doing great, but kids still love, you know, want to be their idols, and they want to be Andy Carroll, and they want to be whatever, and the shirt costs and the kit costs and all that. It's a lot of money. And like, you know, we haven't got any players, so we'll have to have new names in the back of the shirts next season.
That's it. Right, here's a question. Does it make a difference if you get Andy Carroll with a single number on the back? Is that less than if you get two numbers?
I actually think it is done by the letters and different things. The Kelvin El Hibatamin, our favourite, was a lot of letters. But I don't know. I don't know if it's set pricing for the players' numbers and whatever. But, you know, people get the patches and all those kind of things. And it's the cost of living, cost of football, cost of life at the minute is huge. And that's just another one to factor in, isn't it? Which is hard.
So are you saying you hope we don't sign any players with double-barreled surnames? Is that what
well, you're saying? Well, I keep Guinness more. Walker. Guinness Walker's good one. Yeah. I like that one.
Deco Dover Reed, we could sign him. Yeah. Won't fit on the back, but
there's a ready one for Forster Caskey. There you go. That'd be a link to the past, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
I'm sure there's a few more out there.
Yeah. So anyway, a bit more of a development. We're still waiting for an announcement on the new Reading manager, who that's going to be. We don't know when that's going to be. We think it will be relatively soon. That would make sense, but we don't know.
Although I did say on that, Mark, I saw on the website when they talked about the season tickets, you'll get to meet the new manager the 2nd of June. So they...
okay. I didn't see that.
Yeah, it was on the spiel. I read it yesterday that it was, you know, it's a benefit of a season ticket holder. You get to meet the player and do this, and you get to meet the manager on the 2nd of June. I hope that works out, because it could be a bit embarrassing, isn't it?
Yeah, well, maybe that's why they're paying extra then. For the season tickets.
Who knows?
Anyway, the manager situation. So that sounds like a new manager will be confirmed by June the 1st, which is what, about 2 weeks away, isn't it?
Yeah, which we kind of would hope, weren't we, anyway?
Sometime in the next 2 weeks. And I think players are back. Is it first week of June or middle of June? I'm not sure.
So I think they usually have like a 6 week break, don't they? The summer and then back. So you're looking middle of June, maybe, I'm guessing.
But also,
and then pre-season sort of friendlies in July. And
also, a manager will want to get new players in for then. So could be this week. We don't know. So we're actually recording this yesterday, which doesn't make any sense saying that now, but we're recording this on Monday evening, so it's going out on Tuesday, which by the time it goes out is tonight. So that's why the season ticket prices were announced today, as in Monday, but as of when the episode goes out, it happened yesterday.
And that's been so good getting it right saying yesterday as well.
Yeah, so that's why we get confused. We try and pretend that we're recording it on the day sometimes, but anyway, yeah, there you go. So the reason for saying that is, by the time this goes out, this might be irrelevant because we might know who the manager's going to be. But as things stand, Chris Wilder is still the favourite. We said that someone was going to come up as a new name, as one of the favourites, and that's happened this week already. Luke Williams, Notts County manager. And Danny Cowley as well is currently joint second favourite with Luke Williams. So Danny Cowley, ex-Portsmouth. Johnny, we've talked about Chris Wilder. What do you think about Luke Williams? Just one promotion through the playoffs with Notts County. Obviously, they had that ding-dong battle with Phil Parkinson's Wrexham. I think they ended up with 107 points, didn't they? And still didn't go up automatically. Luke Williams, if he's announced as a new manager, how would you feel about that?
I don't know too much about him, to be honest. I won't lie that he's not, you know, he's done well with Notts County. Again, would you want to leave a club like that with, you know, jumping into a big ring possibly? But he's just got them back into a league. Maybe he sees that as a work in progress there. He's, you know, it's so hard to say. I think anyone that gets into the headlines all of a sudden becomes a candidate for a job, don't they? It becomes, like you said before, like, you know, the betting thing, somebody mentions his name, he puts the bets and all of a sudden they're second favourite, third favourite, whatever. I think he's managed in the league, hasn't he, previously, from my memory. Don't know how successful he was. But yeah, past history doesn't matter. I don't think it's about the right person. I did see him scootering down the middle of a road about midnight. I think some celebrations for Notts County. So
was that anybody in the Oracle, though?
It could have been. It's a midnight entry into the Oracle, one of the scooter, different way of doing it. But yeah, I don't know. And it's so hard to be. You could have any random names being mentioned at the minute. And I'm kind of like, we just need to. It just needs to be done soon. I think we just need to put speculation.
We know in the next couple of weeks. I think possibly by the end of next week, possibly by the end of this week. We don't know. What was the other thing I was going to mention? It will come to me any second now. It's gone. Anyway, never mind. So last night we had Brian Tevreden on, the former technical director. We actually had him on earlier today, but...
You're giving it away now.
I know, I messed it right up, haven't I? So I think I was going to say something about the manager then, but it's gone. Can't have been that important. But yeah, Brian Tevreden, really enjoyed that. So thanks to you, Johnny, for organising that.
No, it's Jason, a friend of mine. Jason managed to
Jason Treby, is it?
Yeah, sound. So, you know, that...
So we have to do a bit of networking sometimes, don't we, to get these guests on. But really enjoyed that. He spoke about Ron Gourlay. We were always going to ask him about that, how he really felt about him, how he felt when he left, basically because of Ron Gourlay, had enough, so he left. And then two months later, Ron Gourlay left. And, asked him about that. But he said, look, you don't know at the time. So
No.
And then the revelation, exclusive, he revealed that he tried to sign Erik ten Hag as Reading manager. Yeah. Imagine that.
And we didn't have 300,000 to spare then, and we've wasted 190 million since. Isn't that ironic?
Yeah, that is a bit ironic. So look, I think I still can't remember. So let's get on with our top five influential people in Reading's history. And again, we like to do our... who just missed out from the list. So I'll start with mine. So basically this is, as the name suggests, the kind of headline, the title of this episode, top five influential people in Reading's history. So it's who's made a significant impact on the club, the development of the club, etc. So the following names didn't make it onto my list, but I do think they've had a significant impact on the development of the club. One of those is Alan Pardew. I think he came in and I think he had a particular kind of formula, particular style as manager. I think he was instrumental in building some foundations for what was to come after he left.
Yeah,
and obviously he went on to West Ham, didn't he? Did well after Reading as a manager. Another one that didn't make it onto my list was Maurice Evans. Again, I think he was influential. Had a great Reading team, put a great Reading team together in the late 70s, early 80s, and then the success continued with Ian Bramfoot, who's the next name that didn't make it onto my top five influential people. The reason I mentioned Ian Bramfoot is because he showed that if you find a way to be effective and you find solutions, you can be successful. He certainly did that. The other one, definitely considered putting him on my top five. And I don't know who's on your top five, Johnny. This name may well be, is Nicky Hammond. The stuff he did with recruitment and bringing people into the club. I certainly would say he falls into the category of someone who helped develop the club. And then I don't know who this person is, but whoever appointed Catalyst, the performance consultants, which may well have been somebody like Nicky Hammond. I don't know, but yeah. I think if you look at the way data is now in football, and you know, the not really the money ball approach, but certainly a lot of data is available now. A lot of data is used to analyze performance and so on. So I think actually getting Catalyst in, the performance consultants, I think that really, really helped. And obviously, you know, that's the, that period in Reading's history is been our, has been our most successful. So they're some of the names that missed out on my top five. How about you, Johnny?
This has actually been really the hardest one for me. I know that we're going to go through this and I'm going to go, oh, geez, I forgot him or I forgot them. And I've been trying to think of, you know, not obvious ways, but different things that have gone on. And those, some of those names, Nicky Hammond, Morris Evans, you know, they were a couple that, well, one with the fan favourite is Ron Grant. You know, as a backroom person that knows the club so well and did what he did without any kind of fanfare. But he was kind of, you know, that one of those background people that that kept the club together and did a lot. That, you know, I think, you know, you kind of, all Reading's history is linked with certain people. And even before then, I was going to say the other one was Gordon Neat, going back, you know, being the groundsman, again, you know, played and then did a long-term role at Reading. You know, again, people that born after whatever age wouldn't know so much about them. But, you know, that, trying to get down to five and trying to think, it's really hard because I think there have been so many influential people, isn't there? And through for such a long time. And again, going back before we were fans, I'm sure people would bring up people from the past, but we, you know, the only ones that we're kind of familiar with. But yeah, so I apologize to anyone if I've missed anyone. And it's because I'm going, I don't know. So, like, yeah, I'm trying my best, and the top five numbers have changed and changed and changed and changed.
Well, I'm pleased you mentioned Gordon Neat and people like Ron Grant, because you know, I was thinking of him as well. And younger Reading fans might not know this, but I certainly remember this, talking about Gordon Neat. This is really harsh on Gordon, but it's one of the things that I think it was, he was the groundsman at the time. I can't even remember what season it was. It was in the mid 80s, I think. And it was just before the start of a new season. I think Gordon Neat was groundsman. And unfortunately, he didn't dilute the weed killer. So all the grass went brown. But that's a bit harsh on Gordon, because he was a loyal servant to the club. I don't think it was at the start of the 85-86 season, but it was in the mid 80s.
Yeah, it was, definitely remember.
Yeah, I think so. But yeah, that's doing him a bit of a disservice, but certainly, you know, that's a memory of supporting Reading in the 80s. The away team must have been a bit surprised when they turned up and where's the grass? The grass was there, it's just a different colour. Let's start on our top five countdown. Would you like to go first, or would you like me to go first, Johnny?
I'll go first. I think you were first last time, weren't you?
Yeah. So who's your...
Okay, again, five? this could be a sliding doors of top five. First one I've gone for is Roger Smeat. Yeah. And it could be Roy Traynter as well, alongside him as his sidekick, because of what they did back in the 80s to get the club away from Mr. Maxwell. And then, you know, to be chairman, I think, for the next however many years before Sir John took over. I think he oversaw, you know, a successful time in Reading's history, pretty much with the 86 season and then the Cymbeline Cup and all that. But he had a massive role in where the club is at now. Again, I don't know, you might mention him or not. He could have been anywhere in the top five. That's how hard it is to kind of put in a position. But I certainly think his influence on keeping us as a club and then going on from there was huge. That was the number five for me. Without him, we wouldn't be here today. You know, that's...
Yeah, been the Thames Valley Royals podcast.
Yeah.
Ooh, anniversary. Not quite the same ring to it, is it?
No, I think I'd have a lie down after that.
So, yeah. So my top five, my number five is Steve Coppell, because I just think he oversaw as manager the greatest two seasons in Reading's history. 106 season, winning the championship, and then the following season, those two seasons together, what he did as manager, in a way was revolutionary, because it was he was sort of the head of a really successful club, and he was the figurehead of that. Obviously, Sir John Madejski was, for the club, but in terms of the team, and the team behind the team, if you like, and the recruitment of players like Kevin Doyle, Dave Kitson, Leroy Lita, Ingemarsson, Hanneman. Really enjoyed the story about how Marcus Hanneman was signed for Reading. They just saw him in a warm up and they thought, yeah, that would do. But they had been kind of looking at him before then. But I just think, in terms of that word influence, he oversaw the team, and he was, he was the figurehead of all of those other people like Brian McDermott that were involved, Nicky Hammond as well, part of that team. So I've got Steve Coppell as my number five in terms of an influential person in Reading's history. So that's my number five. Who's your number four, Johnny?
He is Steve Coppell. And for the same reason, for me, he represents, like you were saying, all of those managers and backroom staff that took us to where we did in 2005-06. It wasn't just him. It was Brian McDermott. Brian McDermott could have been on this list as well for me. Maybe he's on yours. But that squad of people starting, Tommy Burns, even bless him, to a lesser degree, at the start of the new stadium. But then when Pards came in, Martin Allen, how it all developed, that process. And Nicky Hammond, like you were saying earlier, was again one of those unsung heroes, wasn't it? People, we've never had he did some amazing deals for this club, as in got rid of some players, and how we got rid of the money we did, God knows, but the players we brought in. But you could see, it was like we've had guys on the podcast, it was a process, it was a jigsaw. They knew what they were doing, they had a plan, and when Pards left, Steve came in, developed it. Brian was there at the background when Brian came in. He took it, and that's to me, Steve Coppell's just the figurehead, like you said, of all that group of people that made this club special.
Yeah,
and so, Steve was just the icing on the cake.
Yeah. So moving on to my number four, and the reason I've got him at number four in terms of an influential person in Reading's history is because without him, from what we hear from other people, it wouldn't have been as successful. And there's some key reasons why. It was Eamon Dolan. So Eamon Dolan, the way he developed the youth players, how highly respected he was thought of. And I think that is one of the factors that's been missing in recent years, the Eamon Dolan factor. Sadly passed away. We've got the Eamon Dolan stand, but he really kind of, people loved him. We're talking about players that came up from the academy. Noel Hunt has talked very fondly about him. So he was, a fantastic person, a really lovely man. But actually, what he did for Reading Football Club, I don't think he's an unsung hero, but he probably deserves a lot more credit and a lot more kind of song and dance in a way about how influential he was for Reading. So, just well loved, well respected, missed. Players talk very fondly of him, Jem Karacham, people like that. So I think he had a big influence, and he was a key part of such a successful period in Reading's history. So that's why I've put Eamon Dolan as my number four. So, Johnny, over to you for your number three.
Number three, I've gone actually Nigel Howe. And it really flashed up with me when we were speaking to Brian that when he left, things went pear-shaped. And again, he's an unusual character. I think he came back a couple of years ago for a while, didn't he? He came and stepped in. I think it was during COVID times in a role. But I think, you know, he was the driving force and the quiet driving force of all that good that we've talked about with the teams and the state and the move to the new stadium. And obviously he's a businessman, but he was part of that team. And I think he was quite quiet in that team. I don't really ever think, you know, he would be someone that would be out in the public eye singing and shouting how great he was. But he was kind of the nuts and bolts man for Sir John and the link between the teams. And, you know, if only ever, you know, had someone like that recently doing that job, you know, and that from what Brian said the other day was kind of, it brought it home to me. It's like, oh, geez, yeah, that's somebody that was.
Yeah, and Nigel Howe's not on my top five, but it's like you said earlier, could have very easily been for the reasons that you've just said. So I mentioned Nicky Hammond earlier, who wasn't on my top five, but I'd include Nigel Howe on that. And actually, when we spoke to Brian yesterday, stroke earlier.
Today, tomorrow.
Brian Severidan, this is, you know, he kind of confirmed what a lot of Reading fans thought, that you know, when Nigel Howe left, things started. That was the decline. I think you could possibly say, well, you know, that's the point when things started going really bad for Reading, was after Nigel Howe left, and then Brian left as well, and Ron Gourlay was CEO, and you know, and as Brian was saying on yesterday's episode, recorded earlier today, you know, Nigel Howe being replaced by Ron Gourlay, didn't work. So, Nigel Howe could have easily been on my top five as well. My number three, similar kind of reason in a way, is Brian McDermott. And the reason I say Brian McDermott, obviously manager, took Reading back up into the Premier League. Yeah. But I think he was a key part in, you know, supporting Steve Coppell, the development and recruitment of players. You know, Kevin Doyle highlights what Brian McDermott did. And that team of people, I think this is quite tricky, this list, because, you know, we're talking multiple people kind of as part of a team, and that is why they were influential, because they were a key cog in an effective team which led to success. So Brian McDermott, Eamon Dolan, Nicky Hammond, Nigel Howe, etc. But I just think Brian McDermott was at Reading for a long time before he became manager. And just such a big influence. And obviously Steve Coppell and the players got all the praise, to John Madejski as well. But Brian McDermott deserves a lot of praise for what happened, you know, when Steve Coppell was manager as well. So that's why I've got Brian at number three. Who's your number two, Johnny?
One you've already mentioned, Eamon Dolan. Again, like, you know, we can quibble over second, third, fourth and fifth. I think they are just influential people that the Eamon, like you said already, like, you know, his influence on Reading was massive. The you know, what he did, the amount of academy players that he brought through that did well at Reading, and also other clubs that moved on elsewhere. But everyone absolutely loved him. And he was someone that set the standards for the academy players to work to, and was a magician at what he did. And like you said, a lovely guy as well. On top of all of that, he was such a kind human being that made would help make the club what it was. You know, without those players coming through, you know, the gems and there's a list so long that, you know, they all say such nice, kind things about him. Just wish he was still here, wouldn't we? You know, at the sea. But yeah, that's my number two.
Well, my number two, I'm guessing might be your number one, Johnny, and it would be the obvious choice, inverted commas. My number two is Sir John Madejski, and there's a reason which I'll explain why he isn't number one. But Sir John Medeski, you don't need to say too much about him. I'm guessing he's your number one, Johnny, but I'll let you do the big reveal. But he came in at Reading and just didn't just sort of change the club. He evolved Reading in terms of identity, success, what the club stood for. And I use that in the past sense because we've lost some of that now. Hopefully it's going to come back. But I don't think we'll ever have another club the same as we had with Sir John Medeski. And if you think about not just the stadium, but just the way he ran the club. Yeah. We've got in our recent history a really good example. Brentford are doing something similar. Brighton are doing something similar. And Reading certainly were a good example of how to run a football club. Did it in the right way. And by that I mean, you know, Sir John Medeski ran it on good foundations as if it was a business. So this is the budget. You can't go over the budget. And then you had people like Brian McDermott who knew that everyone had a very clear vision, and that came from the top. That came from Sir John Medeski. So people like Brian McDermott, Steve Coppell, they knew what budget they had. They knew what type of players they wanted. So they identify players like Kevin Doyle, who are the right type of fit for Reading and within budget as well. So that all came from the top. That came from Sir John Medeski. So I'm guessing I know your number one is Johnny. So I hand
over. This is the moment now. I go, oh sugar, who have I missed?
You forget.
Well, there's one that's jumped out.
I don't think you've forgotten Sir John Medeski somehow. But go on.
No, it's the one that you've got the number one. I'm going, oh, how did I think of that one? It coming left field from my head. But yeah, no, John Medeski. I mean, it was that era of people that are in charge of our club, and they. You know, from him, like you say, you know, leadership comes from the top down, and it came from him through all the other people that we've mentioned. You know, Ryan, Steve, Pards, or you know, then through the coaching staff. John Fern, even that you know we had on with us, you know, as another backroom person. They were all bought into that same ethos as people, didn't they? And they're all good people. And they're all good people that worked together and had the same belief and the same idea and the same passion. And it was like just magic when it all comes together and works like that for a club like ours. And like you say, we're never going to have that again. Hopefully we'll get back somewhere close to where we were, but I don't think it'll ever be special like that. It'll just be a different...
Yeah. Look at what's happening at Newcastle. That's clearly... A lot of that is to do with the money, same at Man City. Obviously, that's enabled them to bring in people like Eddie Howe, and I think he's done an amazing job there. But with Sir John Medeski, yes, it was about money to an extent, but it was much more about the way that he ran the club. Really good example of a good way to run a club.
And community as well, wasn't it, Mark? Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you. Yeah, it's about Reading as the community in the town and everything
identity
else.
As well. Yeah, absolutely. So my number one is Roger Smee. And I'm going to kind of include people like Roy Tranter in this as well and all those directors. And the reason is because this is a list of my choices for top five influential people. What Roger Smee did was find a way to block the proposed merger. If that hadn't have happened, if the merger had gone through, then we wouldn't have had a Reading Football Club. So we wouldn't have had all the success we had under John Medeski. So that's why Roger Smee is my number one. And I'm singling out Roger Smee because he was the... You know, he was the figurehead. He put all that together. And my understanding is that Roy Tranter kind of delivered it. But it's the same, you know, that's like saying the 106 team you know, taking credit away from Steve Coppell as the manager. So yeah. Roger Smee was the guy that put all that together. My dad was involved as well. You know, Brian Roach, former Reading director. He was involved in the publicity for Roger Smee, all that sort of thing. Roger Ware was who we've had on as a guest, former Reading Chronicle sports editor. I think that, you know, a few of the directors, I think, was it Colin Brooks, one of the directors that was involved? I can't remember, but certainly Roy Tranter is one of the key men in there. He was, I think he was one of the directors that spoke to Roger Smee. But it was Roger Smee was like the manager of that team. He wasn't just the figurehead. He made it all happen. Yeah. So without Roger Smee and all of those people, 40 years ago, none of the rest of it would have happened. So that's why Roger Smee is my number one in terms of influential people at Reading.
Yeah.
I completely understand why you've got Sir John Medeski at number one. It's kind of an obvious choice. I know that a lot of fans would choose Sir John Medeski if they were doing their top five. But that's why I've gone for Roger Smee. Johnny, is there anyone else that we haven't mentioned that you've thought of while we've been talking?
No, I mean, like, geez, like, you know, that, you know, as I was saying, like, you know, when you said Roger at number one, I was like, thank goodness, at least I had him on my list. So I was just getting you to come up with someone completely going on, I've completely forgotten. But it's like, it's, you know, as I say, like, Roger, but like, you know, I said, like, Roger, without him, we wouldn't be a club, end of. I'm sure there is other people along the way that we're not doing a disservice to that, you know, has played a massive part in Reading's history. And I think there's a lot of people that have worked behind the scenes in, you know, the administration that, you know, the normal day-to-day people that have been part of the club's history as well. Do you know that?
Yeah.
You know, that's huge. And that's what kept, you know, when Brian Tevin was saying, you know, people left under Ron Gawley that were the heart and soul of the club. And then we lost the heart and soul of the club from that, you know, and that, those people are special people that knew the running of that club. Like Brian talks about, you know, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? Like that
yeah.
You can't buy that. You can't just bring someone in and replace. Yeah.
And if you remember back to our very first episode on series one, you know, people like Andy West, okay, yeah. not really an influential person as such, but in terms of, you know, someone who's had a role to play, the backroom staff, yeah. You know, anyone, I don't know the guy's name, but I even remember Elm Park in the 80s. I don't know if you remember him. There was a steward who was at every game. Yeah, it's a huge guy. He was probably about 6'7". Quite a, you know, well-built guy as well. And I don't know what his name is. Somebody from, you know, supporting Reading in the 80s, yeah. I don't remember. But people like that. You know, and you made a joke about Kingsley, but kind of everyone that's played their part has been influential in some way.
Yeah, in a different way, isn't it?
Yeah.
Isn't it? That's people, the thing.
People have the turnstiles and, you know, I mentioned before Catalyst. I mean, they've played their part in the club's history. Mark McGee and Colin Lee coming in as a partnership, sort of Reading's version of Brian Clough and Peter Taylor in a way, where Mark McGee was the figurehead, but Colin Lee had a lot to do with the success of that team and, you know, almost going from what is League One straight up into the Premier League almost, and would have, you know, second place would have been good enough any other season to go up automatically.
There's a couple of others as well. I was just thinking of them. We're talking, like, you know, from some supporters trust. There's Mel and Colin who have been doing the bus, all the transport for years. You know, unsung heroes. They cop it sometimes, but they do the nuts and bolts stuff of getting people to games. You know, it's not a you know, attractive job, but without them, again, you know, the support, you know, wouldn't be there for that. You know, people like that, people that have been part of the history.
Do you know?
And that's.
Yeah, do you know who I think we should crown the winner of this is probably the Reading fans, because without the Reading fans, in the same way that Roger Smee, former Reading player, came in and, you know, save the club with the help of all those other people. You know, without the fans, there wouldn't be a club. The club belongs to the fans. So people like Sir John Medeski, people like Roger Smee, you know, all the successful managers, they've done that on behalf of the fans. The fans is the club.
Yeah, they got it, didn't they?
Yeah. So I think one of the messages to the current owners is, you know, communicate with the fans. Like Brian Teverdon spoke about that. He communicated with people. He wasn't afraid. And sometimes he's absolutely right. Sometimes when you come out and you explain the thinking behind some of the decisions, people go, oh, yeah, I hadn't thought of that. And they respect that. But that's one of the issues at the moment is we don't know what's going on. So we're going to like naturally draw some of our own conclusions. And actually,
I think Mark Bowen's doing, you know, he's starting to talk a bit more and he's getting there, but it needs to be consistent. It needs to be, you know, about the issues that matter for fans, isn't it? And trying to give.
Yeah. And you've got to engage with the fans because, you know, if the team's not winning on the pitch and it's not a good experience, you're not going to get fans going to the games. You know, some fans have come out, you know, and people could think what they want about it, but the season ticket price rise, some people are saying they're going to boycott. They're not going to buy a season ticket because they think it's outrageous that the price has gone up. Mm. You know, it all comes back to the fans. If suddenly Reading don't have any fans, then there isn't a club. So we'll say it's Sir John Medeski, Roger Smee, and the Reading fans are the winners.
That's a good way of summing it up.
Yeah. All right. And Johnny, I do have to congratulate you because we're coming to the end of this episode. Our top five seasons went on for about an hour and a half, probably a bit too long. And your guess for this was 45 minutes. And you're spot on because we're at the end. So you've gone for Sir John Medeski as most influential person in Reading's history. I've gone for Roger Smee. And you know, we obviously talked about the importance of the fans as well. So that's it for our Reading FC top 100 series. So thanks, Johnny, for all your thoughts on favorite players, managers.
It's been fun, mate. I've enjoyed it.
All that sort of thing. It's been interesting, hasn't it?
Yeah. Hard work.
Yeah. I think it's just difficult sometimes to think. I mean, I was having kittens, like I just confused myself. Like, do I put Ian Brownfoot number three? Has he been more successful than Alan Pardew? You know, and then in the end, you just have to make a decision.
And I was going, oh, geez, I don't want to offend anyone either. Like, they're all brilliant, they're all great. But I don't want to go, oh, geez, I can't believe, upset Dylan Kerr by picking Nicky Shorey over him. Yeah, I still don't think he's forgiven me, so I'm kind of a mixed.
He's never ever letting you forget that. No. Never. That's he's going to remind you of that long after we stop doing the podcast.
Yeah,
that's for sure. But so that's our Reading FC Top 100 series. All of the episodes still available to watch on YouTube and to listen to wherever you get your podcasts. So we talk about our favourite players. We talk about our, you know, favourite seasons, favourite games, managers, and our most influential people. If there's anyone else you can think of that we haven't mentioned and why we should have done, please feel free to get in touch and we'll give them a shout out. But guests coming up tomorrow, Wednesday, from 6 p.m. onwards, Andy Bernal, former Reading defender. Then on Thursday from 6 p.m. onwards, Reading women's defender Lily Woodham, and Friday evening, Linvoy Primus, surprise, surprise, from 6 p.m. onwards. And you can watch all of our series episodes on YouTube. And we're starting to put some of the Series 1 episodes on YouTube because Series 1 was audio only. We've still got some, not all of the recordings from Series 1, but we have got some. So we're going to be putting out some of those as YouTube videos as well, just as kind of bonus episodes. But that's it for our Reading FC Top 100 series and our top five influential people in Reading's history. So thanks for that, Johnny. And see you on tomorrow's episode with Andy Bernal.
Absolutely. Been fun.